Hi, I am Paolo Marconcini from the University of Pisa, and I'm going to give my invited talk to the 12th International Conference on Circuits, Systems, Signal Processing, Communications and Computers 2020. My talk is about a model for 1 over F noise in graphene and in more common semiconductors. First, I will talk about the different flicker noise behavior observed in several graphene samples and in more common semiconductors. Then, I will describe the physical model that we have developed in order to study to understand this difference. The physical model we have developed is based on the conservation of the mass action law and of ne electron neutrality, and includes also the effect of potential disorder. Then I will show the numerical results we have obtained with this physical model for monolayer and bilayer graphene first, and then for more common semiconductors. Finally, I will draw my conclusions. As you know, graphene is a two-dimensional material made up of one or a few layers of carbon atoms arranged in an hexagonal lattice. In particular, monolayer graphene consists of a single layer of carbon atoms, while bilayer graphene is made up of two coupled layers of carbon atoms. Graphene has very attractive electrical, thermal, optical, mechanical, physical properties, which have attracted the attention of the academic and industrial community. Measurements performed on several graphene samples have shown a quite different flicker noise behavior with respect to more common semiconductors. As you surely know, flicker noise, or 1 over F noise, is a type of electronic noise characterized by a power spectral density inversely proportional to the operating frequency. Flicker noise originates from the presence of impurities or traps, which randomly trap and trap electrons from and into the channel of the device, giving rise to current fluctuations and thus to noise. In ordinary semiconductors, the flicker noise power spectral density is approximable with the empirical Auger formula, which is this one. In particular, this formula tells us that the power spectral density, as I, is inversely proportional to n, which is the number of carriers in the device. And thus, the power spectral density is greater when the number of carriers in the device is lower. In most of monolayer graphene samples, a lambda-shaped flicker noise behavior as a function of the Fermi energy or of the charge density n has been observed, as you can see in the first two panels of this figure, exactly as in common semiconductors. Instead, in suspended monolayer graphene and in most of bilayer samples, an M-shaped behavior has been measured, with a local minimum near the charge neutrality point, where the carrier density is lowest, and this is in contrast with Auger formula. These experimental data have been extracted from this article by Pal et al. In order to explain this difference, we have introduced the following physical model. We have related the macroscopic current at the terminals of the device to the microscopic phenomena inside the device through the Ramos-Shockley-Pellegrini theorem, and we have obtained this relationship in which we consider an uniform contribution of the drift current in every point of the device to the current at the external terminal. Since the main effect of the trapping phenomena is the variation of electron and hole density, so of N and P, we have written the variation of the current, delta I, in this way, considering that only N and P vary. Then we have divided the current fluctuation delta I by the mean drift current, which is this one, and we have obtained this expression. Then, if we define as n in upper cases, np in upper cases, n as the total number of electrons in the overall devices. In the overall device, the total number of mobile electrons, and P as the total number of mobile holes in the total device, we obtain this expression. Now, delta N and delta P are considered, the fluctuations, the variations are considered with respect to the situation in which the trap is empty, and so it has not trapped any electron. When an electron is trapped into the impurity, by the impurity, we have a value of the variations delta N and delta P, which can be found enforcing the conservation of the mass action law and of the charge neutrality in the device. In particular, we have differentiated the mass action law, obtaining this first equation. We have enforced the charge neutrality in the device, obtaining this other equation. And from this system, we have obtained these expressions for delta N and delta P. This means that the charge of the trapped electron is mainly screened by a local reduction of mobile electrons when electrons are the dominated carriers. We obtain this result from this first equation. And instead, is mainly screened by a local increase of mobile holes when holes are the dominated carriers, as we see from this result. In intermediate conditions, there is a combined actions of the two effects. If we substitute these values of delta N and delta P inside the previous equations, we obtain this relationship where key is a random telegraph process, which is 0 when the trap is empty and 1 when the trap is full, because when the trap is empty, the variations are 0 because they are variations with respect to the situation in which the trap is empty. Instead, when key is equal to when the trap is full, the result is what we have obtained here from this system for delta N and P, which then we have substituted in the previous equation, and so we have obtained this result. From this result, we obtain the corresponding spectrum. Since key is a random telegraph process, its spectrum is a Lorentzian function. Then, if we combine the contribution of several reciprocally independent traps with properly distributed time constants, we obtain a spectrum which has this kind of dependence, with the McWhorter model, and which means that the spectrum goes like 1 over f. Gamma is nearly 1, okay? And if the mobility of electrons and of the holes is equal, we have that the spectrum is symmetric with respect to the charge neutrality point, where the spectrum vanishes. Otherwise, if the mobilities of the electrons and of the holes are different, the spectrum is asymmetric. And the degree of asymmetry depends on how much the mobility differ. We have included in our model also the effect of the potential disorder, because we have randomly distributed charged impurities, which give rise to a random potential energy. We have included its effect by averaging the previous result of a Gaussian distribution of energies in this way. This is a Gaussian. The standard deviation sigma of the Gaussian depends on the impurity distribution, on how much how many impurities are in the device, and on the screening efficiency of the material, on the how well the material is able to screen the effect of the impurities on the potential. Okay, in the case of graphene, we have computed the electron, the mobile electron concentration, and the mobile hole concentration using these expressions, where we have exploited the density of states, which depends on the graphene dispersion relations and is obtained from the graphene dispersion relationship, and on the Fermi energy occupation function. These values of N and P are required by the previously described physical model. In graphene, the mobility is the same for electrons and holes, and therefore the spectrum is symmetric with respect to the charge neutrality point, where it vanishes. In particular, in the charge neutrality point, the variations of electrons and hole concentrations are opposite, as you see, and this is obtained from the previous equations with N equal to P. And therefore, the variations of the current, as you can see here, goes to zero, and therefore the noise vanishes. Here I have represented the behavior of delta N and delta P as a function of the Fermi energy for monolayer and bilayer graphene. And these results confirm what we have said, that when holes dominate here for negative Fermi energies, the charge captured inside the trap is screened principally by holes, while where electrons dominate for positive Fermi energy, the charge inside the trap is screened mainly by electrons. We have computed the power spectral density behavior as a function of the Fermi energy, and in the absence of potential disorder, we have obtained the behavior represented in red at the left for monolayer graphene, at the right for bilayer graphene. And we see that the spectrum is symmetrical, as we have said, and that it vanishes at the charge neutrality point, at the Dirac point. If we include in the model the presence of potential disorder, we pass from the red curve to the green one, then to the blue, magenta, and cyan curve. And we see that the effect of the potential disorder is to smooth the noise behavior, okay? And in particular, increasing the noise, the minimum at the charge neutrality point progressively disappears. The results in terms of Fermi energy are similar for monolayer and bilayer graphene, but we have to consider that if we consider the different dispersion relationships of monolayer and bilayer graphene, we see that in bilayer graphene the screening efficiency is much higher than in monolayer graphene by a factor 6 more or less. This means that for the same impurity distributions we obtain a much lower value of sigma, the standard deviation in the Gaussian distribution of energy that we have considered to include the effect of the disorder. So for bilayer graphene we should consider much lower, about 6 times lower values of sigma. And this explains why in experimental results that have been reported in the literature, in the case of bilayer graphene, a minimum in the noise behavior is observed, while in monolayer graphene, generally a minimum is not seen, apart in the case in which we are considering suspending monolayer graphene, because for suspended graphene the disorder is weaker. So, okay, the reason is that in the case of bilayer graphene we should consider lower values of sigma with respect to monolayer graphene. Now, let's consider the case of more common semiconductors. In particular, we have considered germanium, silicon, gallium arsenide, indium arsenide. Clearly, in this case, we are treating three-dimensional devices, so we have to generalize the physical model to the case of 3D devices, considering volume integrals instead of superficial integral and volume density instead of superficial density. In this case we have considered for NMP, which are needed in the model, these expressions, which are the semi-classical expressions for the carrier concentrations. And in the case of these more common semiconductors, electron and hole mobilities are different. Therefore, the spectrum vanishes not in the charge neutrality point, but in a different point. And above all, it is not symmetric with respect to this point. In particular, the asymmetry is much more visible in the cases of gallium arsenide and indium arsenide, where the difference between the electron and hole mobilities is larger. Here we have I have reported a table with values used for these materials: germanium, silicon, gallium arsenide, indium arsenide, which have been ordered in the sense that germanium has a lower difference between mu-n and mu-p, while the difference between these mobilities increases towards indium arsenide. Here in this slide, I have reported the behavior of delta p and delta n as a function of the Fermi energy for germanium, silicon, gallium arsenide, and indium arsenide, and this confirms what we have already seen about the fact that when holes dominate, the charge in the trap is mainly screened by holes, where electrons dominate, the charge in the trap is mainly screened by electrons. Finally, I have shown the spectrum as a function, the flicker noise spectrum as a function of the Fermi energy for germanium, silicon, gallium arsenide, and indium arsenide. The red curves are the spectra which have been obtained in the absence of potential disorder, sigma equal to zero. And then the other curves have been obtained introducing disorder, which increases from the green, blue, magenta, and light blue. Cyan curve. What we see is that the spectrum is highly asymmetric, in particular in the case of gallium arsenide and indium arsenide, where the mobilities of electrons and holes are very different, also the spectrum is very asymmetric. And the minimum is less visible, is less prominent, in the sense that, for example, in the case of indium arsenide, it is difficult to notice the difference between the minimum and the part at the left, where the spectrum is low, and the same for gallium arsenide and in part also in germanium and silicon. So the minimum is less visible, is less prominent. When a disorder is included, we see that it is sufficient, a very low level of disorder, to make the minimum actually disappear. And therefore we obtain a lambda behavior. A behavior with a maximum, and then it goes down again. And this is the behavior characteristic of common semiconductors and in agreement with Auger law. So, in conclusion, we have explained with our model based on the conservation of charge neutrality and mass action law, the difference in the flicker noise behavior between graphene and common semiconductors. And in particular, we have concluded that a minimum in the flicker noise behavior can be observed, should be observed only if the mobilities of electrons and holes are very similar and the potential disorder is very low. In the other cases, a minimum should not be observed, for example, in the case of ordinary semiconductors. And this analysis could be useful for the design of low noise electronic devices. Thank you for your attention, and I conclude here my presentation.